Hello there, and welcome to a brand new Let's Play here on my channel. This is WRC 2 Extreme for the Sony PlayStation 2, developed by Evolution Studios and published by Sony Computer Entertainment Europe for release only in Europe. This game would be the second in the series of the Evolution Studios officially licensed World Rally Championship games. Their first effort, World Rally Championship, would be released in 2001. This game is the follow-up, hence WRC 2. And the extreme part we'll get to later. This game focuses on the 2002 World Rally Championship season, which would see Marcus Grönholm crowned Drivers' Champion for the second time. Unlike in 2001, where it was a very tight battle all the way to the end, with Richard Burns eventually being crowned champion at the final round, 2002 wasn't even close. Marcus Grönholm won by over double the points of second place Petter Solberg, and then Carl Sainz came in third. So let's head into the WRC mode. Of course, being a fully licensed World Rally Championship game, this has all of the manufacturer teams and drivers that were running in the 2002 season, with of course the notable exception of Colin McRae because of his own game series. Anyways, before you can jump into the career mode, we have to choose our difficulty. Currently we can choose between a novice and professional, and then the third difficulty, expert, is unlocked by beating the game on professional. So we need to get to the expert difficulty, so we're going to start with expert, which is two stages per day, damage on and also penalties on. That means there is six stages per location, as opposed to novice where there would only be three. So you can select one player, two player, three player or four player. I'm assuming this is sort of a pass the controller around the room style experience, where one of you would go out, set a time on the stage, and then the next person goes along. Of course we're very lonely, so we're going to choose single player. And here is the car selection screen. And as you can see, unlike in the previous game, these are fully rendered in engine. The game car models, in fact, look much better than the previous game, because the polygon count has almost tripled. And also, in addition to being able to look at the cars rotating around this podium at admittedly a slightly sort of inconsistent frame rate, we can look at some statistics, so we can find out how much a manufacturer has won, championship wins, rally wins, and when they were established, some overall statistics on the car, technical specifications, and also a sort of small blurb on the car's history. So to choose from, we have the Peugeot 206 WRC, which would be Grönholm's chariot, as well as the car that would win the overall team's championship. The Ford Focus RS WRC 2002, which looks very, very good. The Mitsubishi Lancer Evo WRC, which also looks very good, although unfortunately this would be when the Lancer would switch to the Stadia platform, which was very, very doomed, unfortunately. The Subaru Impreza WRC 2002, probably the best looking car in the game, although unfortunately it's the car we used in the first game, so no use of that. The Skoda Octavia WRC, probably my personal favourite because it's just such an underdog. The Hyundai Accent WRC, which we used for our professional playthrough of the first game. And finally, the Citroen Zara WRC, which makes the game go very shaky, probably because it knows the power this car will hold in just a few years' time. So, for our career mode, we are going to be getting into the Skoda Octavia WRC. So far, no manufacturer wins, no championship wins, no rally wins, and the team was established in 1969, which doesn't look all that good, although admittedly, when it says established in 1969, it's not quite as you would believe. Technical specifications, 300 brake horsepower, as all these cars have, 400 meters torque, as all these cars have. All of them have 2-litre turbocharged engines. This car is unique in that it has a 5-cylinder engine as opposed to the usual 4-cylinder. The tyres do change. Some cars use Pirelli, some cars use Michelin. The weights are slightly variable and each car has a 6-speed transmission. Skoda have a strong history in rallying, but the Octavia WRC is its first foray into the demanding arena of the WRC. The car saw its first rally in 2000 and 2002 is its first full season. The Octavia is the biggest car in the WRC and is well suited to the Safari and Argentina rallies. So from there we have a choice of drivers. We have Ericsson, who has 6 rally wins apparently. We have Tony Gardemeister, who is a junior Finnish person and has no rally wins. We have Cresta, who is apparently quietly confident and youthful. And finally Stig Blomqvist, who is the oldest driver currently in the WRC. I believe he's 54. by the time that this game came out. He has one championship win and 11 rally wins. And well, you've heard of the youngest champion of a certain sport. Let's go ahead and crown the oldest, because with this guy being 54, the oldest world rally champion, as far as I can work out from Google, was 49 years old, I believe. So let's go ahead and crown the oldest champion.
Picture yourself in some of the most beautiful scenery in the world. Snow-covered Scandinavian forests, sun-baked African wilderness, South American mountains stretching into the clouds. Now imagine blasting through it all in a two-man guided missile. 1 ton of steel and alloy, fuel and air, flesh and bone. 2 liters, 300 horsepower, four-wheel drive. The sound of rocks smashing off the bodywork, the turbo screeching under the bonnet, your heart pounding in your chest. This is the World Rally Championship. 14 rounds on 4 continents, one of the toughest of all motorsport competitions. To beat your rivals, first you have to beat the clock. In a race against time and the elements, every second counts. On gravel and asphalt, sand and snow, from sub-zero to searing heat, you're pushed to the limit and beyond. How do you sum it all up? WRC. Monte Carlo Rally is the first event in the World Rally Championship calendar and combines glamour and prestige with unforgiving alpine roads. One of the reasons it's so special is the sense of history behind an event first run almost a century ago. Another is the fact that a stage can start on dry tarmac and finish on thick snow. To win Monte Carlo means something special, even to World Rally Championship veterans.
And of course, because this is the World Rally Championship, we of course start in Monte Carlo for the Monte Carlo Rally. So we have the choice of a shakedown where we can test the car setups and all the rest of it, but we're not going to bother with any of that. Instead, we're going to jump right into stage 1 and 2 are clear. The Monte Carlo Rally is the first event in the WRC calendar and combines glamour and prestige with unforgiving alpine roads. So before we get into the actual rallies themselves, and indeed at the end of each day, we get taken to the paddock. Here we'll see sort of what we've damaged on the car. You have a list right there. They're all white at the moment because of course there's no damage to the car because it hasn't ran yet. And we have the option of changing our car setup to whatever we want it to be, or we can let the engineer apply the default car setup for us. I'm thinking for this first run, we're just going to sort of leave it as is and see how it goes, which I've never done before. Usually I just apply the default engineer setup, but actually on second thoughts, let's just go with the default setup. How much harm can we cause if we just stick to the norm? And our first stage is called Turriers/Selenet, 5.9 kilometers long, and it starts at 7 o'clock in the morning, bright and early. Okay, so here we are. We've got a very winding alpine road ahead of us, which is not so good because WRC2 Extreme happens to be my least favourite of the mainline WRC games. Now, it's not for something that you can necessarily see. After all, it is a much better looking game than the previous WRC game. It seems a lot more time and thought has gone into this, and that's all great. The problem comes from the physics in this game, which are not so good. So, WRC 1 was very arcadey. The cars did not feel like they had a lot of weight. It was very floaty. It was very weird. Admittedly, that's not great. However, it did make for a rather fun game. In this game, they've sort of gone for a sort of realistic-ish approach, but, you know, some positives. The cars feel a lot heavier. The problem is it feels a lot more random, especially in the collision physics. The sort of impact of walls and barriers in this game is absolutely detrimental, which, considering I'm not very good at games like this, it's not something I personally like. Now, you could sit there and go, oh, well, you know, I'm a super good driver and I'm not going to collide with walls and stuff, so this sounds ideal. Yeah, but unfortunately the car handling just sort of feels kind of unnatural. The cars feel very twitchy, but also at the same time it feels like sometimes you'll pull the steering and sort of nothing happens. It's all a little bit weird. You don't quite know how the car's going to react as it goes through the corner. You could get sliding like that, you could get acres of understeer, you could get something entirely preposterous and the physics could throw your car into the air. It's very strange, it's very hard to get used to, and it's not something I'm a massive fan of, I've got to be completely honest. I think the later games did a better job on the driving front. They managed to be more realistic while still being sort of slightly more forgiving, as well as just having better overall stage design. The problem in this game is the stages are very narrow. Don't get me wrong, in a rally game you want narrow, you want you know, a fine line between what you can get away with and what you can't get away with. That's the fun of rallying. But with the way this game works, with the whole collision physics and also the handling being sort of super rough to get used to, you don't want a wide, or you kind of want a little bit more of a wide stage, or you have a bit more wiggle room. But because this game is sort of very super obsessed with angles and so on, it does make things a little bit harder. And that's sort of where the extreme part of its name comes in. Now, extreme refers to something else, which you'll see later on in the game, but it also refers to the stage design, because they've taken more liberties with it. Don't get me wrong, there's still sections that you may recognize from real-life rally courses. They did go ahead and sort of try to replicate them to an extent, but they've also tried to make them a little bit more extreme. The angles on ramps and the angles on hills are much more extreme than they would be in real life, so on and so forth. Also, the game has a replay mode, as did the first game. That's what I'm going to be using to get thumbnails for, hopefully, provided the cameras are good. I can't say I've really checked. Either way, we did win that stage, and after the end of each stage, you get sort of a timing sum up of where everyone came, so we'll have a quick scroll down. We were 1.75 seconds quicker than Gronholm, followed by Loeb, Giles Panizzi, Bugalaski, I think that's how you pronounce that, Mäkinen, Francois Duval, who replaces Colin McRae, Petter Solberg, Mark Martin, Carlos Sainz, Schwartzman, Delacour, Rovanperä, Alistair McRae, Ericsson, Toshiya Arai, Freddy Loix, Richard Burns, Thomas Radstorm, Tony Gardemeister, and Cresta. So there are our 21 drivers that are going to be competing with us. I'm not going to go down the full time sheet for every single stage we do, although I will run down it at the end of the results, because I think it's interesting to see where everyone came. And of course, there are championship standings for the top six drivers. So on to the next stage, Point de Clans / Velora Suva. I cannot do French, I apologize. 14.3 kilometers long, a hell of a long stage. Okay, so hopefully this should be a little bit wider. The lighting is a little bit nicer to us, of course, not starting us right in the daytime. And this is sort of where the game gets to show off another thing going for it, which is the very long stages. Now, there were long stages in WRC1, but this game takes them to new levels. You can have, you know, 14, 15, 16 kilometer stages. They are massive. They take, can take up to about 7 or 8 minutes to complete. So they're pretty good fun, and they're also pretty lenient on the AI time. And it's actually quite interesting that this game can manage that, but I remember the original Dirt Rally, and I think even Dirt Rally 2, they developers said they had massive issues with trying to implement super long stages. I think even the modern WRC games suffer from that, and yet this game can do it. I'm assuming it's probably something to do with the fact this game You know, the draw distance isn't as good, and I would imagine there's something going on in terms of the streaming, sort of unloading chunks of the map that are behind the car, because as far as I'm aware, you can't actually look back in this game. There are different camera modes. There's sort of a wider chase cam, as you can see there, which feels a bit like driving Micro Machines. There is a very obnoxious bumper cam, a sort of slightly better bonnet cam, two interior cameras, which are absolutely unusable, as is basically every interior camera in every game that was made before 2011, and then finally this sort of basic chase cam, which is the one we're going to be using. And of course, because of that, we get to see the beautiful rear end of our mighty Skoda Octavia WRC car. Although, to be fair, staring at the back of our Skoda does sort of bring up an interesting point, that while all of the liveries met here for the WRC were fantastic, it's amazing how simplistic they were when you think about it. For example, this Skoda livery, it really is just the Castrol colours, but they've sort of mixed them with the Skoda logo, which is of course also green. So you have sort of the green and red of Castrol mixed in with the Skoda badge, and that was sort of the only real sponsors this car has. There's a Speedline sponsor, which is who makes the wheels, but beyond that, that's sort of all the Skoda was. In fact, if you look up the official team names for this season, only two of them actually have sponsors in the title sponsors. Those, of course, being Super, who have the 555 World Rally Team cigarette company, and Mitsubishi, who were Marlboro Mitsubishi Rally Arts Racing at this time. Although, after this year, Mitsubishi would pull out of full-time competition in order to test their car for a better season next time around, because it wouldn't be particularly successful this time around, and the Marlboro sponsorship would actually end up going to Peugeot, which led to some rather awesome looking liveries for a couple of years. And that's sort of where it's quite funny how we associate, you know, red with Mitsubishi and blue with Subaru, but that really just came from the sponsorship that the teams had. It wasn't so much anything to do with, you know, a clear, concise brand image or anything like that. It was more just that's what companies sponsored them. Same thing with this white Skoda. It's white because Castrol sponsors it. If Marlboro sponsored the Skoda, it would be bright red. It would also probably look a little bit like a Evo because, you know, they kind of look similar, I guess. Sort of similar rear-end design to a Lancer if you sort of squint hard and beat yourself around the head a few times. Of course, you know, the Lancer, not as good-looking as this Octavia. It is a fantastic-looking rally car, this one. A very, I would say, underrated, although not really, because it wasn't very good. I don't think it ever won a rally. It got a podium, as far as I'm aware, a safari rally at one point, I believe it was, but beyond that, this car didn't really go to achieve much. And in fact, even though it was the biggest car in the WRC, it would actually end up getting replaced by one of the shorter cars, that being the Fabia, which would be bought out the year after this one, and Skoda was hoping for more success with that, and it didn't really come. So that's sort of Skoda's history. But this was back when you could fail in the WRC, which doesn't really happen anymore, you know. Well, especially these days in modern WRC, there's essentially only three teams. There's Hyundai, Toyota, and M Sport. Admittedly, M Sport hasn't really won all that much. I mean, I think they won 2017 and 2018 Drivers' Championships. Not sure about how their manufacturer standings looked, but, you know, they just sort of stick around and their semi works anyway. Whereas the Toyota and Mitsubishi outfits are sort of more, or sorry, Toyota and Hyundai efforts are manufacturer back. So this was back when you was allowed to fail. This is back when you was allowed to have something like the Hyundai rally team at this time, or the Skoda Motorsport team, which didn't do very well, you know, even though they dumped massive amounts of money in it. This is back when manufacturers liked to dump money into motorsports that weren't just Formula E. or GT racing, or WRC 2, because there's a fair amount of cars sort of looming around there, including the Skoda. Skoda's done very well in junior rally circuits, not so much in like actual rallying, but junior rally, Skoda is very, very good at indeed. So, good on them, I guess. But yeah, this was sort of back when you had Toyota and Honda in F1 with factory teams and so on. That's sort of how time has passed by. I guess sort of in motorsport, costs have kind of gone up even since, you know, the early 2000s. Costs of running various motorsports have gone up. I mean, just look at modern day WRC cars. You know, not only are they based off smaller subcompact cars now, or rather, I think these were subcompact cars, they're just like straight city cars, really. You know, your Yaris's and so on and so forth. But they also have the giant aero packages and so on and so forth. And, you know, back in the day, these cars, you know, they weren't cheap to make. They're not too much like a modern road, or they weren't too much like the road cars they were supposedly based on. At the end of the day, there wasn't a 300 horsepower fire-breathing Octavia with all-wheel drive, which is a shame. There was the VRS model, but that's not really the same as this. But yeah, I mean, these cars were expensive to make, but probably not as expensive as the modern-day Super Mini rockets that we see about. Either way, we did very, very well on these first two stages. We actually were 19.19 seconds ahead of Granholm, followed by Panizzi, Makinen, Solberg, and Bogolaski, who drops down to 6. Granholm stays 2nd, Panizzi up to 3rd, Makinen up to 4th, Solberg up to 5th, which means Loeb and Duval have sort of dropped down a little bit, which is a shame for them. We will continue without saving, ignore that previous same game. Stage 3 and Stage 4 look like they're going to be cloudy. Let's go ahead and go to the paddock. So, here we are in the paddock, and as we can see, we've damaged the brakes and the tyres on our car. There's 5 real-time running minutes, as you can see here, and we're going to go ahead and repair those. And there we go. So you sort of see the time limit of how long something takes to either fix or adjust as well. I think adjustments actually do take time as well, which is interesting. But overall, while the damage seems like it would be consequential, the actual damaging of most components is usually just limited to brakes, tires, and body, and pretty much everything else will be alright. I don't think I've ever really managed to damage any major component beyond that. Anyways, 8.2 kilometers, Tuden Puget Finnairs, stage 3. Alright, here we are. The sun is... I don't actually know what the sun's doing. I didn't read what the time was. It looks like it's setting there at the moment, which means we're going to get some bloom to deal with, which is very modern gaming, but also... Well, I say modern gaming, it's not really anymore, is it? Games don't really try and sort of blind you with the sun anymore. Not as much as they used to anyway, back in the Battlefield 3 days. I remember that was the whole issue a lot of people had with that game, was the ridiculous amount of bloom and filters and so on it had over it. Actually getting slightly stuck on that guardrail there, but we got through it. Lots of handbrakey turns here. It's basically what Monaco is it's sort of hairpin left, hairpin right, hairpin left, hairpin right. I mean, it's not too far off that in real life, but especially in this game, it's very hairpin-y. Gonna damp the brakes a little bit. We are 4th apparently through there, which isn't too great, but we should be able to gain a little bit of time, because the next stage is the one that worries me, so we're going to try and get a decent lead ahead of ourselves before we get into that. Also, this bridge is very slippy, which is interesting. I'm not quite sure what's going on with that bridge. Maybe it's ice over or something. I can't quite tell, because it all looks the same sort of texture-wise, but yeah, weird icing over going on there. Little damps of the brake. Also, you might notice, as with the previous WRC game, I have gone ahead and upped the audio of the co-driver. So, the co-driver is louder than the car, and especially louder than the music, which I only found out while trying to edit a segment, which didn't happen. The sort of in-game music audio is actually pretty loud for this game, so turn that down a little bit. They also turned the sound effects down a little bit, so hopefully you can hear me over this. But the co-driver, I do need to have a little bit more volume, just because I need to be able to hear what his calls are. I can't hear them too much, but you know, if there's like a caution or something like that, it's always good to be able to hear that. Unlike in the previous game, there's no cheating either, because there's no map to help you out on this one. So gotta bear that in mind. It does, the handbrake's actually in a pretty cool place. It's actually on the R2, so it's literally right at your fingertips to pull the handbrake, which is nice. No manual mode in this game. I'm using automatic gear ratios because, as forementioned with this game, sort of weird handling, I can't keep up with a manual gearbox. Chances are, in games after this, I will probably be using the manual shifter, if I remember, just because that should be easier to deal with, but right now, my brain is sort of struggling to compute this game enough as it is, because again, it's very weird handling in this one, so trying to cut the hairpin right, instead of going to get a decent power slide going, which is lovely. Gonna hit that barrier though, which is not so lovely. So far though, we've been doing reasonably well here in Monte Carlo. This was a rally I was worried about because it's very tight and twisty, and also a tarmac rally, which we know from previous experiences, none of that stuff really bodes too well for me, but it's not going too badly here. I will say, anything I do wrong rally-wise in this segment, I'll simply put down to tiredness. I am very tired. I recorded this earlier and it made me slightly angry. So I'm recording this quite late on in the night, and also I've did a lot of stuff earlier in the day. I've essentially just been looking at Vegas all day and editing through mass amounts of footage of Forza, so. Alrighty. Anyways, enough about my woes. We stayed ahead on that stage, not quite as much as I would have liked to, but we did stay ahead, which is the important part. And so we are 3 seconds up on Panizzi in that stage, then Solberg, Mäkinen, Granholm, and Delacour. Granholm is 31.73 seconds behind. Gilles Panizzi is right on his tail in the other Peugeot, followed by Mäkinen, Solberg, and Bogolaski is still doing pretty good. So 5.9 kilometers, 2020. This stage is a night stage. And a night stage means you can't see jack. Hence why the car's got these big fog lights fitted to them. And much like in the previous WRC game, when this is night stage, it means it night stage. This isn't like that one that we had in Sweden, which was sort of, you know, pretty good because the snow was just red. It was pretty easy to see. This game, no, when it's night stage, you legitimately cannot see a damn thing, which is incredibly annoying, and also equally annoying, the AI do not let up during these night stages, so yeah, can be interesting to say the least. I'm not above the whole turning up the brightness on my television in order to make us see better during these, but hopefully it shouldn't come to that. It won't come to that during this stage because I've got a healthy enough lead to sort of, provided I don't mess this up too badly and throw away a really good deficit, we should be alright. Got a lot of long turns going on here. Eighth fastest, sort of, with Delacour. So that isn't too terrible. Lots of hairpins. Again, the problem with the night stuff, of course, Andrew looks better on your end, or at least it should do, through editing. You'll probably be able to see more than I actually will. Realistically, I probably need to get one of those new fancy Elgatos that has the non-lag gameplay built in, so I can just play it straight through there and actually have more visibility, but those are expensive. I ain't gonna spend a load of money on this anymore, so just sort of deal with it like we used to way back in the day. But yeah, these night stages are incredibly difficult. Realistically, driving through this on bonnet camera probably would make things easier, but that bonnet camera probably is gonna make me sick, so I am not going to go ahead and do that. Gonna go uphill. That's not what I wanted to do. We're probably gonna be finishing less high than 7th, but this has actually gone surprisingly. If I can get a top 10 in a night stage, I'll be happy, because these night stages, as I said, the AI don't really seem to take into account it. Whether they will, for example, if it's raining, usually they'll actually be, it's actually easier to win a stage when it's raining, because it seems like that sort of gets more factored in than this does. Of course, they're AI, you know, they can see in the dark, they've had all their carrots and so on, so they should be okay. So we are definitely off the pace. The question is just how far off the pace are we? 11 seconds, 9th place overall. It's not a great result, Tony, but it isn't too bad. All things have to be said. So let's see how we did. Tommy Mäkinen was the fastest, followed by Solberg, Benizzi, Sainz, Burns, Delacour, Duval, Loeb, and then us. We still retain our lead. Jonas Benizzi, though, gets bumped up to 2nd. Mäkinen goes to 3rd, Solberg to 4th, Bulgalski to 5th, and Loeb to 6th. So, let's see. Yeah, Marcus Grönholm, the champion. Well, rather, he wouldn't have been champion at this time, but you know what I mean. Has retired, along with Mark Martin, which is something the AI can do in this game, which is quite fun, actually. They can retire. So, on to stages 5 and 6. And, of course, broken on the car is brakes and tyres. I'm surprised I haven't damaged the body yet, although I suspect that won't be something that we keep up with too much longer. On to it, then. Puget Ferenc / Tudon. Start time of 6 a.m, 8.2 kilometres long. IRL, this rally would have taken place just after my 5th birthday, so that's interesting to know. It's actually kind of sad when to think about it that way, because this game is, it will be 19 years old this year, which is very weird to think about. In fact, next year it'll be 20. In fact, actually, if you want to feel older than that, Gran Turismo 3 turns 20 this year as well, so. And, unarguably, this game is probably aging better than I am, in all honesty, despite running in 4:3 aspect ratio and all the rest of it. I should point out, this game looks especially pretty on emulation. I've actually seen this running 4K, widescreen, all the rest of it. And it does look absolutely stunning. Of course, though, I do not do emulation. I don't record off a PC, because it's not very, I wanted to do this properly. Elgato, PlayStation 2, 4:3 aspect ratio, boom, boom, boom. So this game would look better emulated. And if you're running, or rather, I should say, it's also running on the recording, as you probably see by now, in 4:3. I was thinking about maybe bumping this up to 16:9, but as sort of correctly pointed out to me, PlayStation 2 games just don't run 16:9. in general, even if they have the option to do it, it's not really 16:9, it's just putting that weird widescreen filter on things. So I will be running the game in for free, because that's the way it was intended to be played, and doing anything else would be slightly pointless. So we're gonna run in for free for the duration. I think I'm gonna have like a little information screen on the left side of the screen, just so you have at least something to look to, like a little banner or something. But yeah, that's the way it would work. If I didn't have that crash, I probably would have still been ahead up there, but I do not. That being said though, we did have a decent lead over Panizzi, and of course we've got rid of one of our rivals, Gronholm now, who is a big rival as well, so that's good. In case you are wondering, this rally IRL would be initially won by Sebastian Loeb, however his Citroen would get disqualified for, I can't remember what it was, I think it was something to do with an illegal tyre change, which would eventually drop him from the lead of the rally. I might have disqualified him, or it might have got a time penalty, I can't remember which, but either way, it would be Tommy Mäkinen that would actually win this round, on his debut for Subaru no less. Unfortunately for Tommy, in what I believe will turn out to be his final year in sort of rallying driving competition, this would be the only win he'd get. After this, he would retire from the next three rounds before eventually managing to finish a rally. So yeah, things were not going too well in the Tommy Mäkinen camp. And it is kind of weird when you think about it that Mäkinen finished in a Subaru, in the same way that really Richard Burns' career, although unfortunately that was due to far more tragic reasons, his career would actually end in a Peugeot. Even realistically with Richard Burns, while you sort of associate Subaru with him because that's what he won the title with, Burns really was all over the place. Kind of like McRae as well. McRae often gets associated with Subaru. But in truth, McRae was very much a mover around the grid as well. He sort of started out in Subarus and then would eventually switch to the Ford Focus from 1999 to 2002, where, you know, that car would be featured in CMR3 and all the rest of it. That would be a car you'd figured would be associated with McRae more than the Subaru, but not so much. And then also he had a brief stint at Citroen as well for 2003 in the Zara, which doesn't often get brought up because it didn't end very well, and eventually ended up with him taking what was originally planned to be a sabbatical, I believe, from WRC, although unfortunately he'd never actually returned. That's a big knock, because I really wanted to send it over the finish line. That was a poor stage, it has to be said, and I think I may have finally damaged the car a little bit more than I did previously. So that was a pretty poor stage. We got 5th, 13.69 seconds. So moving into the final round, Charles Panizzi is just 14 seconds behind, followed by Mäkinen, Solberg, Loeb moves up to 5th, and his teammate moves down to 6th. So all is going pretty well so far. So our final stage, 5.1 kilometers, start time of 11 a.m. Let's hope this goes better than that stage. Also probably going to stop trying to pronounce these. Cherini / Le Bollier. I was joking. I don't know why I'm trying to pronounce them. Maybe I will, maybe I won't. I can't actually decide. Anyways, I'm pleased we're not using the interior camera, because that would be pretty useless right now. Managed to already scratch up our prized Skoda. She is not looking as hot as she did earlier today. It does have to be said though, mechanically it actually feels pretty sound if you ignore the damage to the actual car itself. Damage model, not bad. pretty linear, it has to be said, of course. You know, various parts of the car damage in very specific ways. Kind of like the old GTA games where they had, you know, if you went into a post flat out, it, you know, the damage would always be sort of in the same places and stuff, so. That's all going on, but either way, try not to worry about that too much right now. Let's just worry about actually getting our heap of Czechoslovakian, Czech Republic, Šeska steal over the finish line. It is always kind of weird to me how Volkswagen let Skoda sort of do whatever they wanted when it came to rallying, and especially considering Volkswagen did actually have its own rallying effort. They had a Volkswagen Golf F2 kit car, which was being ran in the Junior WRC. It kind of makes you wonder why Skoda was the scapegoat for it, unless they just wanted to get the brand out there maybe as like a whole thing for dependability and stuff. Either that, or, you know, it's just something Skoda had before the acquisition, and Volkswagen was like, yeah, alright, you can keep doing that, I guess. Gets the name out there. Volkswagen not quite as open to certain things. Although, in fairness, I will say, for the entire Volkswagen group, they've all seemed to run pretty much independent of each other. Volkswagen just sort of lets the different mates do whatever they want, hence why Porsche's, you know, admittedly it's a bad example because Porsche does have a massive history of Le Mans, but, you know, realistically, at one point in Le Mans history, it was Audi versus Porsche, which essentially is just two VW group members smashing lots of money at each other and competing with each other, so not quite sure what's going on there. Anyways, that is it for Monte Carlo, and while a bit mucky at the end, that was still a pretty good stage. Panizzi, us, Makinen, Sainz, Burns, and Radstorm. And there we go. We'll go over the final times in a minute. No, let's quickly go over them now, because I can't remember if it... we'll figure that out in a minute. Anyway, final times, 25 minutes, 15 seconds for us, followed by Charles Panizzi, 10 seconds down. Makinen, 30 seconds down. Solberg, 51. Then Sebastian Loeb, 1 minute 14. And Bulgarski. So the Citroen's doing pretty well. Subaru boy's doing well as well. Peugeot, only one in the top six, which was interesting. Followed by Sainz, Delacour, Duval, Richard Burns in 10th. Unfortunately, his debut for Peugeot not going too well. Alistair McRae, Rovanperä, Radstorm, Gardemeister, not doing too bad in the other Skoda, Schwartzman, Loix, Eriksson, Cresta, and retiring from this rally was Toshiya Arai, Marco Martin, and Marcus Granholm. So there we go, not too good from those guys. Let's overwrite the save, and this game does take a while to save, so, oh, never mind, it did it. Straightforward though. So on the actual point front, we gain maximum points for winning the Monte Carlo rally. So we're on 10, Charles Panizzi on 6, Makinen on 4, Solberg on 3, Sebastian Loeb on 2, and Bulgarski on 1. And that does mean as well, after round 1, that in the Constructors' Championship, we are tied with Subaru for the top spot, followed by Citroen with 3, Ford with 2, Mitsubishi with 1, Peugeot with none for some reason, and Hyundai with none. I have no idea how the manufacturer points work, I'll be honest. Either way, there we go. Congratulations. First on the podium. Don't win anything for it, but even still, first on the podium is good. And we can see the points once again. And I think if I click next on this, it will take us straight to the next rally. So, I'm going to thank you all very much for watching. I do hope you've enjoyed this first edition of WRC 2 Extreme. Next time, I'm going to be taking a look at the Rally of Sweden. So, join us for that. Until then, farewell. Dreams are going. I'll only be
putting